We are embarking on an expedition to the heart of a global threat.
We're doing science.
We're pursuing an environmental mystery. Why are some of the world's waters lifeless?
This is the dead zone in real time, right now.
Here, girl.
What we discover affects us all. The Earth is a water planet. More living creatures live beneath the waves than in our world above them. But our actions are creating vast underwater areas where nothing can live. These are dead zones. 400 have been identified around the world so far. We are undertaking an expedition to explore these strange phenomena and to uncover what causes them.
I'm Philippe Cousteau. Join me for EarthEcho Expedition into the dead zone. I'm on an adventure to explore one of the most extraordinary ecosystems in the entire world. But it's an ecosystem that's plagued by an invisible menace, one that threatens the very survival of the Chesapeake Bay.
And we're about to embark on a journey to find out more. The Chesapeake Bay is our nation's largest estuary, a transition zone where fresh water from six states and the District of Columbia meets the Atlantic Ocean's salt water. As these two worlds commingle, they form a nursery for many species, including birds, fish, and mammals. But not everything is as it should be, because part of the Chesapeake is a dead zone, an area that is devoid of life.
Now, to really understand dead zones, I'm gonna have to get in the water and see it for myself.
Dead zones are threatening one of the bay's keystone species. It's an organism whose presence affects all other species, including the livelihood of people who make their living from the bay. We're on a quest to find oysters. Steve Allen manages aquatic restoration programs with the Oyster Recovery Partnership, an organization that is devoted to reintroducing oysters in places from where they vanished.
Steve, what can we expect to see down there?
We're gonna be diving on probably about three-year-old oysters that were produced in our hatchery in Cambridge, Maryland. Should be nice oyster clumps. It's one of our main restoration sites that we've been doing for the past 3 years here.
Terrific, let's get in the water.
All right.
Excited. And these hoods?
They're just protection. There are sea nettles, which are like jellyfish.
More than a century ago, oysters filled the bay, and this region supplied nearly half the world's demand, but a combination of pollution, over-harvesting, and disease killed them off, crippling the bay's most effective filtering system and forever changing the lives of the bay's watermen and fishermen. Oysters are known as ecosystem engineers. As they build their shells, they're creating places for other animals to live.
And you see these oysters are all covered with barnacles and mussels, providing substrate for each other.
And that's not all they do. Oysters are filter feeders, taking in water and removing organic material from it to feed on. They cleanse as they filter, so an entire oyster reef acts like the bay's kidneys.
One of these oysters can filter 50 gallons of water.
Right.
That is remarkable. And what I find even more shocking is some of the statistics about how there's 1% of the traditional historical oyster population left here in the Chesapeake Bay.
That's one estimate.
1%!
Steve and this project hope to kickstart Mother Nature by adding more oyster habitats to help them continue their comeback. But a growing dead zone could destroy the recovery, and my next stop should help me understand the nature of the threat. I'm meeting with Dr. Beth McGee, the senior water quality scientist with the Chesapeake Bay Foundation.
We're gonna hoist it up.
Hoist it, all right. So these are all the monitoring devices here.
This instrument is called a CTD. It's an array of sensors that collects and records data in real time as it moves through the water column.
This is the surface, and this is the bottom. The one that we're most interested in is this, which is dissolved oxygen, which actually is not too bad.
But when it comes to other parts of the bay, things don't look so good. Dead zones occur when nutrient-rich runoff from human activities causes an enormous growth in the amount of algae in the water. And as the algae die, huge populations of bacteria grow to feed on them. And it's this bacteria, because they're animals, they consume most or all of the oxygen in the water.
It's pretty simple, right? There's oxygen in the air, and if there's not enough oxygen in the air, we suffocate because we don't have enough to metabolize and survive. It's the same thing in the water, even
that's
though
right.
Fish don't have necessarily lungs.
They're taking water in, running it over their gills, they're
extracting
the oxygen, that's right.
So there's not enough oxygen in the water.
Fish
they
can
can't
move
survive.
Away. Well, and some of them can move away.
If they can't swim away?
They can't swim away, then they're going to die.
They're
going to
suffocate.
That's right. That's why we call it the dead zone, is because it's not livable, basically, for the critters that live in the bay.
Oysters are at a particular disadvantage because they're what scientists call sessile, meaning they're animals that live fixed in one place.
And all those important oysters that we learned about can't survive in a dead zone, and you start to see the whole connected ecosystem begin to collapse.
That's right.
Dead zones have not taken over the entire bay, at least not yet. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA, is also trying to help the bay's oysters. Today, they're out gathering baseline data on animal populations in an oyster sanctuary where oysters can't be harvested.
So we just deployed the net out here into a particular scientific zone. We've only got about a minute of the trawl left, then we're gonna pull it up, we're gonna see what's inside it, we're gonna record that. It's gonna give us a sense of what's happening beneath the surface of the water.
North your surface. All right, let's get her in there. Let's put the bag in this one.
A lot of stuff in there.
NOAA biologist Steve Giordano is heading up the study.
There's a chain of crabs in here.
We measure everything. This is a Callinectes sapidus, the blue crab, and then we do a carapace width, which we do
from point to point on
their carapace. And in this case, it's metric, and it's about 165 millimeters on mine. And then we release all of the animals we catch.
Finding so many different species and age ranges is evidence of diversity.
15.
That means that this sanctuary is doing well.
Okay. Pretty cool, huh? This is science at work, not a bad day at the office. There needs to be good conditions for these many animals to be able to survive. Of course, if it's hypoxic, if there's not enough oxygen, they wouldn't be.
Animals that can move will move. When there's not enough oxygen in the water, they would suffocate otherwise.
The baseline data we collect here will allow NOAA to monitor the relative health of this area in the future.
This is ground zero for the dead zone, and I've seen it with my own eyes, but the question that I have is why? What is causing this problem? And to find out, I'm going on a journey to track the sources of the dead zone throughout the Chesapeake Bay watershed, all the way back to the beginning.
EarthEcho International recognizes that young people are making a difference in the health of our water planet. Watch as our expedition team joins students working at the Annapolis Maritime Museum in an oyster monitoring project. Go to www.earthecho.org to watch this and other inspiring stories of youth taking action.